Jetpack technology is getting better, and maybe someday, jetpacks will be available for your everyday commute. But what if, instead of just using a jetpack for a short trip, you went straight up, and up, and up, until you reached space? How powerful are jetpacks? How fast would you have to travel? And what is the death zone? This is What If, and here's what would happen if you flew to space on a jetpack. You wouldn't be the first person to jetpack around space. In 1984, Bruce McCandless flew untethered in space using NASA's Manned Maneuvering Unit. But you wouldn't just be flying a jetpack in space, you'd be flying to space, which means you'd have to travel through all five layers of Earth's atmosphere. And the only thing between you and those crazy atmospheric conditions is a spacesuit. It's definitely not going to be a smooth ride. First, you'd need to choose your jetpack. The classic turbojet engine jetpack uses kerosene-based jet fuel, and it consists of two engines with fuel pumps and computers to keep the thrusts balanced. But right now, kerosene-fueled jetpacks could only propel you straight up into the air for about 8 minutes at 193 kilometers per hour. Another popular jetpack fuel is hydrogen peroxide. If you mix that with nitrogen, a chemical reaction creates pressurized steam, which creates thrust. The packs weigh around 57 kilograms, and they can be 2.5 meters tall. One tank of hydrogen peroxide fuel could get you going at 160 kilometers per hour. But do either of these have enough power to escape Earth's atmosphere? Nope. Neither kerosene nor hydrogen peroxide fuels have enough density. You'd need a fuel that weighs less and packs more power, because you'll need to move very, very fast. Now, that fuel doesn't exist yet, but we're not gonna let that stop us. All right, you've got your jetpack. Now, it's time to put on your spacesuit. You'll need something like the new high-tech SpaceX suits. They aren't just stylish. These suits use fire-retardant Kevlar and Nomax to protect you from extreme temperatures. And they only weigh about 9 kilograms. Instead of plugging into a space capsule, you'd plug into a mini life support system in your jetpack. And you'd need all the protection you can get, because things could get pretty rough after you lift off. To jetpack into space, you'd need to reach escape velocity. This is the speed an object, or you, needs to break free of the planet's gravitational force. You'd be speeding away at 40,000 kilometers per hour. That's quick, but let's play your journey in slow motion so you can really enjoy it. To start, you'd pass through the first layer of Earth's atmosphere, the troposphere. In this layer, you'd see clouds and birds and watch out for that plane! Good job. At an altitude of 8 kilometers, you'd need to begin using your oxygen pack. This is the death zone, as the atmospheric pressure is too low to keep you alive. You'd also notice the cold. As you reach the top of the troposphere, the temperature drops to as low as minus 60 degrees. At 10 kilometers, you'd enter the stratosphere. There's not much to note here. At least it warms up a bit, although the temperature remains below zero. But not for long. At 50 kilometers above Earth's surface, you enter the mesosphere, and the temperature drops again. Once you reach the thermosphere, though, things start heating up. at 85 kilometers above Earth, the temperature can reach 2,000 degrees. Luckily, the thermosphere's air density is so thin that there aren't enough gas molecules to transfer the heat. You won't burn up. It's here, in the thermosphere, that the International Space Station orbits Earth. To reach a stable orbit around Earth, you'd have to reach a velocity of 25,200 kilometers per hour. That's the same speed as the ISS. A journey like this would be dangerous, and before leaving, you'd want to let your friends and family know that you love them, but sometimes it's not easy to find the right words. Luckily, there's Grammarly. Whether it's a heartfelt message or professional email, Grammarly gives you real-time feedback and insights to elevate your writing by improving the tone, word choice, clarity, and more. I use Grammarly for these awesome stories for you. The vocabulary suggestions help me replace boring words with more exciting, effective, and memorable ones. I also use its clarity suggestions to cut out unnecessary words, so our stories are more concise. But awesome science stories aren't the only reason why I use Grammarly. I also use it to draft important emails that need to be both professional and friendly. I really like it. I know that Grammarly's gonna catch my style snafus, my bad grammar, missed punctuation, change my sentence structure. It's the perfect writing tool for anyone who wants their writing to stand out. You can elevate your writing with 20% off Grammarly Premium by signing up at grammarly.com/whatif. That's 20% off Grammarly Premium at grammarly.com/whatif. Now, if you want to venture out even further, maybe to the moon, you'd better be a master of your jetpack controls. You'd need to dodge all the space debris floating around, and it isn't slow-moving stuff either. This space junk travels at speeds of over 35,000 kilometers per hour. Now, even if you don't get clobbered by old satellite parts, we got a problem. You didn't plan for the trip back to Earth, and you're running out of fuel. Looks like this is the end for you, but hey, what a magnificent way to go. Now, if you did die in space, what exactly would happen to your body? Well, that's a story for another What If.